folks, welcome back to BOGObiology. This week we're going to explore energy transformation by comparing the processes of photosynthesis and cellular respiration. Here's what the AP Bio curriculum has to say on the subject. They want you to know that, quote, biological systems utilize free energy and molecular building blocks to grow, to reproduce, and to maintain dynamic homeostasis. Now, all of this is true, but unless you can support this statement with evidence, it's really pretty useless. And also, nobody talks this way. So don't go anywhere, because we're going to be unpacking the processes of photosynthesis and cellular respiration in order to help you understand them better. To begin with, remember that all organisms require a constant input of energy. However, they differ in terms of how they get it. Most organisms do photosynthesis, cellular respiration, or both, though there are a few that buck the trend and do something called chemosynthesis, which does not require sunlight. In photosynthesis, the goal is to store energy, and in cellular respiration, the goal is to release the energy for use. Today we'll begin digging into which organisms do each process, the reagents and products, where each set of reactions takes place, and the major steps involved in each type of energy conversion. Most people know that plants do photosynthesis and that animals undergo cellular respiration, but this is actually an incomplete picture. A number of different kinds of organisms can do each process, and some of them can even do both. For instance, plants use cellular respiration when they're germinating from their seeds and don't have any leaves yet. Now let's talk reagents and products. One of the most important molecules in biology is a rechargeable, reusable energy source called ATP. The energy stored in ATP's bonds power the vast majority of cellular processes, but in the process of powering them, it gets reduced to its low energy form called ADP. However, through a complex series of chemical reactions and a little glucose, we can actually recharge the ADP molecule back into ATP. We call this recharging process cellular respiration. Another way to think about this is that photosynthesis depletes our supply of ATP, whereas cellular respiration recharges the molecules. Looking at the reagents and products often helps make the relationship seem more clear. In photosynthesis, we put sunlight, ATP, carbon dioxide, and water into special compartments in the chloroplasts. Photosynthesis uses these reagents to convert the carbon from CO2 into a sugar called glucose in a process known as carbon fixation. We also produce oxygen as a waste product. Now let's compare the reagents and products of photosynthesis to those of cellular respiration. In cellular respiration, the reagents are glucose and oxygen, and the process takes place in the cytoplasm and the mitochondria rather than in the chloroplasts. The process produces ATP, carbon dioxide, water, and a little bit of heat. Notice how the products of one set of reactions become the reagents in the other. This is exactly what happens in an ecosystem. Here's a quick look at our chart so far. Next up, we'll tackle the location of the two processes. As we previously mentioned, photosynthesis takes place in the chloroplasts, and respiration takes place in both the cytoplasm and the mitochondria. There's more to it than that, though. Both the chloroplasts and the mitochondria have inner and outer compartments that are crucial to the reactions functioning correctly. In the chloroplasts, the inner compartment is called the thylakoid, and the outer compartment is called the stroma. In the mitochondria, the inner compartment is called the matrix, and the outer compartment is called the intermembrane space. Here's what a chloroplast looks like. Thylakoids are pigment-filled discs stacked up on top of each other. Under a microscope, they do look a little bit like pancakes. The stroma is a fluid-filled space surrounding the thylakoids. The membrane that separates these two structures is a crucial part of photosynthesis. This membrane is studded with several key proteins, including light-absorbing complexes called photosystems, and a protein called ATP synthase. Let's check out the membranes in the mitochondria and see if we can spot any similarities. This membrane is also straddled by key proteins, including our good friend ATP synthase. If we look a little bit more closely, we'll see that the ATP synthase protein works closely with something called a proton pump. The pump transports protons from one side of a membrane to another in order to create a gradient. In order to travel back to the other side of the membrane and re-establish equilibrium, the protons have to flow through the ATP synthase. When they do, they reattach inorganic phosphate to ADP in order to create a newly charged molecule of ATP. Harnessing protons and ATP synthase happens in both photosynthesis and cellular respiration. We call this process chemiosmosis. Here's another look at our table. To finish up, we're going to go over the major steps in each process. We'll start by splitting up photosynthesis into the photo part and the synthesis part. The photo part is going to encompass the light-dependent reactions, and the synthesis part is going to be the light-independent reactions, also known as the Calvin cycle. The reagents for the light-dependent reactions are photons of light and water. These reactions generate ATP, NADPH, and some oxygen. The oxygen passes into the atmosphere, but we use the ATP and NADPH in the light-independent reactions. The light-independent reactions perform a process called carbon fixation, where they take carbon from carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and transform it into a sugar. The sugar produces a three-carbon molecule called PGAL, and it's essentially half a glucose molecule. Now let's shift over to talking about respiration. When oxygen is present, aerobic respiration is capable of generating large amounts of ATP. The three major steps are glycolysis, the Krebs cycle, and the electron transport chain. Glycolysis runs on glucose as well as an electron carrier called NAD+, and we also need to kickstart the reaction with a little bit of ATP. Glycolysis produces a molecule called pyruvate, a little more ATP, and some recharged electron carriers called NADH that we'll use later on. The Krebs cycle produces a little bit more NADH, and it also produces another electron carrier called FADH2. The Krebs cycle is kept turning by the input of carbon atoms from glycolysis, and it also kicks out a couple more molecules of ATP and some carbon dioxide. Finally, the electron carriers deliver their payload to the electron transport chain. The electrons trigger the same process we saw earlier. The electrons carried by NADH and FADH2 trigger the pumping of protons from the inner to the outer compartments inside the mitochondria. These protons then flow back into the inner compartment through the ATP synthase, generating ATP. Oxygen serves as the final electron acceptor in this process, and the electron transport chain also kicks out a molecule of water. So to summarize, these are both very complicated processes, but they actually do have a lot of things in common. Hopefully this video has given you a better idea of how to compare and contrast these two processes, and about how different organisms harvest energy from their environment. That pretty much wraps up this week's video, but I hope you'll check out some of my other work on Instagram, Twitter, and of course, YouTube. If you'd like to learn more about photosynthesis, click here. And if you'd like to learn more about cellular respiration, click here. Thanks again for watching, and please remember to subscribe.